So the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, Articles 55 and 57, together provide for the establishment of the Exclusive Economic Zone. That's an area of up to 200 nautical miles measured from the baseline of a coastal state. The shrewd among you will notice then that before the EEZ boundary can be measured, you have to know what your baseline is. And that is also set out in rules within the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea. There are a combination of different methods that can be used to measure that, depending upon the specific conditions of each coastal state. A particular note for archipelagic states, it might be that your baseline actually goes around the perimeter of your island group, which is important for reasons I'll explain. So once the baseline is established, the EEZ is measured up to 200 nautical miles from the baseline. I say up to because sometimes there are neighbouring countries whose EEZ potentials will overlap, and that's particularly an issue, I know, in the Pacific Island region. So the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea also anticipates this and provides a regime of aiming for agreement by negotiation between neighbouring countries to achieve an equitable solution to determine where the boundaries lie. I think it's important. An important point I should make is that the baseline and the EEZ boundary, although how this is calculated is set out in the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, there is actually an obligation on countries themselves to formally declare what their baseline is and where their EEZ boundary is, which is done by means of national legislation and submitting this with the United Nations for publication. I mention this because actually relatively few states seem to have done this. And we're talking about potential mineral deposits in this area and the potential to exploit these for income. And unless you actually know where your boundaries finish and what pools within your jurisdiction, then there may be potential disputes or difficulties with claiming access to those minerals. So it's a sort of cautionary tale is that I would encourage states to prioritise the establishment of their boundaries. So why is this important? Well, once the EEZ has been established for a coastal state, then the coastal state has sovereign rights over that entire area. Putting that in simple, non-legal terms, that means that the country owns everything in that area. Or to put it in more legal terminology, as used by the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, a coastal state enjoys sovereign rights relating to the exploration, exploitation, conservation, and management of the natural living and non-living resources of the water column, seabed, and subsoil. So that includes mineral resources. These are exclusive rights, so no other state can seek to exercise those rights within the EEZ without the coastal state's consent. The coastal country within their EEZ also has the exclusive right to construct and regulate the use of artificial islands and installations and structures, which may include those that are established for purposes of mineral exploration and exploitation. So effectively, again in simple terms, a coastal state has ownership of the mineral resources that fall within this area. And this is actually really quite a big deal, and it's particularly an exciting regime that's established by the Convention for island states and archipelagic states. So I think an oft-cited example is Tuvalu, which I believe has a landmass of 26 square kilometres and has a potential EEZ of 900,000 square kilometres. So if we're talking about the seabed as a potential source of mineral deposits and new income for developing islands, this regime established by the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea is potentially very significant. We've also heard already from various speakers about the possibility for a coastal state to actually extend their maritime zone of national jurisdiction by way of an extended continental shelf claim. So I won't go into too much detail, but I will just say again that there's a particular process that has to be followed that involves lodging information with the Commission on the limits of the continental shelf, which will make recommendations. So it's quite a process. And several Pacific Island countries, amongst others, have actually lodged submissions or are in the process. Why is that important? Well, some of the same rights attach to the extended continental shelf as do to the exclusive economic zone. The difference, you can see it's pretty much the same wording, but it doesn't attach to the water column and airspace. Here we're talking actually about the seabed. And we've also heard from our seabed authority speakers that there's a particular royalties regime as well relating to the extended continental shelf. But again, this potentially means that the UN Convention gives quite a large entitlement over the seas and the minerals that lie adjacent to coastal states once it's been mapped and declared by the state. So those are the rights, and with law, along with rights, always come obligations. We're going to hear more about these later, so just very quickly, this is the same article 192 of the Convention that Michael mentioned. There's a general obligation to protect and preserve the marine environment contained in the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea. You can see it's got sort of positive obligation to protect the marine environment and a sort of negative obligation not to cause damage by pollution, which is actually on my next slide. So states are required to take measures individually and collectively to prevent marine pollution from all sources. Again, we're going to hear from other speakers in more detail about that. We also just have a mention of the IMO, International Maritime Organization. They have also a whole raft of conventions that relate to shipping, which may also be relevant in the deep sea mineral context. And they relate to things like fuel transfer procedure, waste disposal at sea, pollution by ships, and safety at sea. UN Convention on the Law of the Sea also contains an obligation on governments to promote and facilitate the development and conduct of marine scientific research. Provided it falls within these parameters here, i.e. it's for peaceful purposes, it's using appropriate scientific methods, it respects the rights of other sea users, and it complies with regulations, particularly about environmental protection, then governments must allow and facilitate marine scientific research within their national jurisdiction waters. So that's one example, actually, of how international law does impose obligations onto a national law regime. Russell actually opened this morning with an interesting quote from the Convention that states shall cooperate directly or through international organisations such as the ISA to establish appropriate scientific criteria for the formulation and elaboration of rules and practices and procedures to prevent pollution of the marine environment. I think it's really helpful to know that that's in the Convention, because that's really what we're here to do, and it's again, it's the crossover between science and policy and law. Again, we've heard already really about how the requirement to conduct an environmental impact assessment is actually contained in international law. It's contained not only in the Convention, but the courts have also extended this as a principle of customary international law. So we all know that we've got to do it. Governments need to put into their national legislation a regime about how environmental impact assessments should be conducted. But although the Convention and the courts provide that it's a very strong and clear legal obligation, there's not so much detail in international law. There is quite an interesting comment made by the courts in the case that Michael was referring to, which is about the need to balance between sustainable development and environmental protection. So again, that was a comment, I think, from the Secretary General, that we can't be perfect. The environment cannot remain untouched if deep sea mining is going to take place. And it's recognised, I think, generally, that it's an important new revenue opportunity for developing countries. So the question is how to handle this balance. Now, the challenge really, I'm talking about national waters. Well, each government has to put a regime in place, and they don't have within their country an ISA. They don't have a legal technical committee. They don't have a council, an assembly. They don't have a special court. And they don't have the regulations that the ISA has been working on for 10 years in some cases. So it's a challenge. So what do national governments have to do if they are interested to encourage activities within their national waters? Well, again, international law sets some requirements. It tells governments they must have national level laws and administrative measures in place. These must be no less effective than international standards and rules. So that's why we need to look at international law. And it's also really helpful to have the mining code and regulations from the ISA to see what parallels can be drawn for a national government looking at their own jurisdiction. The courts also helpfully have advised that there are no lesser standards when it comes to environmental protection for developing countries than for developed countries. So this is the challenge that a lot of Pacific Island countries are now facing with the support of the SOPAC project, and I'm sure many other countries too. I came here from the UK. Before I left, I met with the UK government and explained that my job was to work with Pacific Islands to develop legislation on deep sea mining. And the UK Foreign Office told me, great, when you've done it, can you send us a copy? Because we don't have any, and we're a bit worried about that. So, you know, it's great that the Pacific Islands are leading the way, but it is a big challenge. And I think it would be helpful for national governments to look at the ISA regulations and some of the things that we've been hearing about, the data collection, the reporting requirements, the way in which environmental impact assessment will be conducted, and monitoring mechanisms will probably need to be reflected also in national jurisdiction. My background really is other types of regulation, where we the general model for regulation is you have due diligence really before you give your license. You then have a set of rules that the organisation has to comply with. You monitor against those rules the activities of the entity, and if it's breaching those rules, you have enforcement mechanisms to stop its activity or to bring it back within the laws. I think that's really one of the challenges for small developing countries who are getting into deep seabed mining, is actually having the capacity, once the legislation is in place, that's the first hurdle, but the next hurdle is really going to be how you can actively monitor and enforce the activities of private sector organisations in your waters. So I just wanted to finish, it's been quite quick for me. We're primarily talking about environmental impact here, and I'm really excited about what the takeaways are going to be to help governments developing their legislation. But I just want to sort of send out a general reminder that for national governments who are set to develop their legislation, it's not only about environmental monitoring and environmental impact assessment. There's a whole raft of other things that countries need to take into account when it comes to regulating deep sea mining. There's a list here of some suggestions from me, other sea users, transparency and accountability, particularly of the funding, the income that's come.